Hello, I'm Gerhard and I'm a data scientist at SAS and lecturer at business schools and universities. A few days ago, I was browsing through my SAS Pressbook Applying Data Science and I thought and go and share with you the case study on the sales manager's problem with you and show you how Monte Carlo simulations can give you a better insight to understand the outcome distribution. In general, analytics and data science is there to help you. It allows you to get a data-driven picture about your analysis subjects, which is more objective and provide you more insight. It also helps you to ask one question in general and get the results, for example, what drivers trigger the higher or lower sales of a product, instead of having to query each feature one by one. Data science also allows you to make the data talk to you. So you ask a question and you get back the answers and the results. And all this can be done automatically. So you receive your result and your findings automatically by just asking one general question, which then can be triggered back to you as an answer. And it's also built, data science is built to do it again. Models can be treated as an asset in order to repeat your analysis, to be rerun on new analysis subject, to be rerun on fresh data. I have compiled a couple of data science case studies in my SAS Pressbook Applying Data Science. And during this webinar series, I would like to share a couple of them with you and discuss them with you. At this slide, you can see the different data science applications and case studies that I'm going to discuss in this webinar. On the left-hand side, we have some supervised machine learning techniques like predictive models or proportional hazards regression models for survival analysis. We will also take a look on unsupervised machine learning techniques in order to make the data talk to us, to get some information out of them. We will take a look on text topic analysis and text analytics, and we will also take a look on Monte Carlo simulations and simulation case studies. You find more content on the SAS DACH YouTube channel. I'm also happy if you follow me on LinkedIn or Twitter, or if you visit my GitHub page, where you can find more content and a lot of SAS samples and code. Let's now jump into our data science case study on how to use Monte Carlo simulation that allows you to better understand the outcome distribution. In this case study, we are going to meet a sales manager and we want to find out how Monte Carlo simulations can give him a much better picture compared if he just takes a look at the averages. So the question is, will the sales manager keep his job? Our sales manager has, at the close to the year end, 21 projects in his sales pipeline, which he still can close in the actual year. For each sales opportunity, the sales manager also has the deal size. You see it here in $1,000. And the estimated probability that this deal or this project might still come in the actual year. So we see we have here some projects, for example, of $500,000, which he estimates it will come in with a 20% chance. There are other projects, for example, $1.7 million, which might come in with a chance of 15%. And then there are other projects, maybe 50,000 euros, where he estimates that this will come in with an 80% chance. So this is his view as his actual year, how he might invest his efforts and how the year might end in terms of his financial numbers. After his weekly phone call with his regional manager, he receives now the following information. If he manages to exceed 2.4 million in total, he will receive a special bonus. If he even manages to exceed the 3 million threshold, he will be promoted to the position of a regional director. If, however, he achieves less than 1 million, then he will most likely get fired, because this is not what regional management expects from his local sales managers. So this is the situation where the sales manager finds himself at the moment. The question is now whether he can feel safe, whether he is on risk to get fired, or whether he has a good chance to receive the bonus or the promotion. The question is now, how can he find out that, and how can he get a clearer picture? So for him the question is, how likely am I in that area, or in that area where I'm safe, or where I can get a bonus or even get promoted? This is his question at the moment. What options does the sales manager have to find this out? There are two ways, two very simple ways to calculate that. A quite stupid one and a very simple one. Let's quickly take a look at the very stupid one. If he sums up the deal sum here, which is 12.15 million, and multiplies it with the average probability that the project comes in, which is 33%, he ends up with 4.5 million, where he would find himself in the promotion area. However, we all agree that this is quite a stupid calculation, which should not be performed. Another way to simply calculate this, which is found very often, is the method to calculate the expected value. For example, he multiplies each deal sum with the expected probability to receive an expected, a weighted value, how much this deal might contribute to his financial results at the end of the year. So he multiplies 1.5 million with 10% and he receives 150,000. And he does this now for every project. A project with 100,000 euros, 40% chance to get it, 40,000 as a weighted sum, and so on and so on. So he performs this now for all his projects. This means he gets out with an expected value of 1.6 million, which means he might find himself somewhere here and say, okay, on average, I think the situation will remain as it is. I will not get fired, and I might also not very likely to receive the bonus or promotion, but I'm safe and I will remain my job. The question, however, is, does this give him the full picture? Can he go home to his wife and say, okay, we might not get the promotion, but I will still remain in my job? Or is there something he's missing with this approach? Let's take a look on two selected projects, on project number 3 and on project number 5. With only these two projects, there are 4 potential scenarios that could happen. He might be able to sell both of these projects, so project 3 and 5 comes in, which means in total this is a deal sum of 600,000 euros, which we see here. And the fact that this scenario is going to happen is by multiplying the two probabilities of 20% and of 40%, as we see it here. 20% times 40% means a probability of 8%. So the fact that this scenario is going to happen is 8%. It also might be the outcome that only project number 3 is coming. So this means he would only get that and not that, which means this scenario might happen with a chance of 20%, chance that project number 2 comes in, and 60%, the counter probability that project number 5 would come in, with 60%, meaning 12%. And he performs this calculation also for project number 5, which means he would get 100,000 euros with a probability of 32%, or that none of the project comes in, which means 0 euros of revenue, which might happen with a probability of almost 50%, namely 48%. This now gives him a much clearer picture in order to find out, to see that it's not only one value for the average, but this is more likely to be a distribution of values. Our sales manager, however, not only has 4 projects, he has 21 projects. So the question is, can we get this output for all 21 projects? The answer is yes. However, you will see that this is quite a large number of projects that we have to consider here. So for example, if no project is sold, we can see here that we have 21 projects of all being set to zero, which will then result in an outcome sum of 0 euros. If, for example, only project one is sold, we see that this is worth $1.5 million. We see only this would be set to yes, the others to no, and we have $1.5 million in the outcome. And we have now to perform this for all combinations, project 2 coming in, project 3 coming in, project 1 and 2 coming in, 1, 2 and 3 coming in, and so on and so on. So we have lots of such project combinations, like for example 2, 4 and 7, which would mean this one and this one. In that case, the total sum would be 10 plus 50 plus 10, 70,000 euros. This would be one outcome scenario. And if you have to run this for all projects, you also have to include the case that all projects are sold, which would result in 12,000,015 euros outcome. In order to calculate this large number, you have to consider this would result in 2 million combinations, more than 2 million combinations for 21 projects. And with any additional project, this number would increase exponentially and you have to perform a lot of calculations. So the question is, can you get this output? The answer is yes. And can you perform such calculations automatically, which is important because you do not want to run 2.1 million such calculations manually? The answer is yes, because the SaaS platform allows you to perform such calculations within seconds in memory and automatically. And the code for this is also very short. You see here, if you would code this, this would just be a few lines of code to get such an output. Let's now look at the output itself, and we would now like to answer, will the sales manager keep his job, will he get promoted, or will he just get the bonus? And the outcome that we see here looks as follows. If we perform the calculation which we saw early on, we see that we have some scenarios which result close to zero. No project is sold, or only a very small number is sold. We have some outputs which are very high number of total deal size with all or almost all projects are sold. And here we have the distribution of the frequency of all other scenarios. I've also added the reference lines for the thresholds under if he stays below 1 million, he will get fired. When he gets the bonus or when he is going to be promoted. And you see now, different to the information of just having the average of 1.6 million, where he finds himself with the value something right here, we see that a substantial amount of cases of scenarios will be lower than 1 million, and the chance that he might get fired is quite high. You also see that there is some chance that he receives the bonus and even some chance that he's going to get promoted. What you also see very clearly is that Monte Carlo simulations provide you much more information than just having one value of 1.6 million, they allow you to see the distribution and the probability that you fall in a certain category or in another category. Let's now on our original display as we saw it earlier, the chance of getting fired, remain as is, having the bonus or being promoted can now be easily quantified with such analysis because you see the number of scenarios that end below the fired threshold can be used to assign a number to this, and to this scenario. And you see here that when you perform this full calculation over all scenarios, we see around 40% he's a 40% risk of staying below 1 million and getting fired, around 34% of remaining as it is, 10% of getting the bonus, 15% of being promoted. This is now a much clearer picture for him, not necessarily a picture he would like to see, but it's much more informative how his risk status is and how his chances are for the various scenarios. Now we would like to study whether there's a different approach to get this calculation out. So the question is, do we really need to perform all these many calculations? We saw that for 21 projects, this was already more than 2 million potential outcome scenarios. If the list of projects now increases, we very easily get to the point that we receive numbers of potential outcomes which are exponentially growing and in the millions or billions. An easier way is to use Monte Carlo simulations. Monte Carlo simulations follow the approach that you do not have to run all scenarios, but you just have to simulate a few selected cases, which still gives you quite a clear picture. Let's have a look at that. This works that way that for each project in the project list, you toss a bias coin. This bias coin now tells you, is the probability larger than 10% or lower than 10%? If it's lower than 10% and the toss coin says yes, you record the project value, in that case 1.5 million. In our case, otherwise you record zero because the project won't come in. You do this now for all projects and record the outcome on the project level. So for example, if you say this project comes in, this does not come in, this doesn't come in, this comes in, this doesn't come in, comes in, and so on and so on. You finally record the number of those projects who came in and use this as the outcome for your scenario, which might be, for example, be in one case something 1.3 million. And you now repeat this procedure thousands of times automatically within a loop and get a quite clear picture of how likely is it that a certain outcome is there and that another outcome is there. Let's now have a look at the results of such Monte Carlo simulations, where we see, for example, the outcome of a Monte Carlo simulation with 1 million iterations and the outcome of the Monte Carlo simulation with 1,000 iterations. So you see that the picture we are seeing here is very similar to the picture that we saw before when we did the complete calculation. So we see that a Monte Carlo simulation with 1 million observations has a very similar shape compared to the true distribution which we saw earlier. However, also with only 1,000 iterations, as we see it here, the basic picture can still be resembled and can also already lead to some conclusions. In order to quantify how close Monte Carlo simulations get to the true result, we now add the results from the 1 million iterations case. So we see that we have very similar results from our simulations when we do 1 million iterations in our case. However, also if we only do 1,000 iterations, we see that we already get a quite close picture to the true result and can also already perform our conclusions out of the Monte Carlo simulations. The code for such complex analysis with Monte Carlo simulations is still very short and simple. As I said, you just toss the bias coin, record the output value. If the project does not come, you record zero, and you just loop over this scenario a couple of times how often you want it. And finally, you just calculate the sum of the outcome value for each scenario, and you see the results as we just presented it. In this case study, we have seen that the weighted average gives you an incomplete picture. It is just one value which might be in the center of the distribution. In order to make good decisions and have a clearer picture about the possible outcomes, you want to study the distribution and to see whether the possible scenarios are very close around the center or are very widespread around the center. And this is what Monte Carlo simulation allows you. Walking from a single value to a more informed picture. I would be happy if you join the discussion at this YouTube video, or if you contact me on social media or other channels to discuss this content and to get your feedback on Monte Carlo simulations. I look forward to welcoming you again in future data science applications and case studies webinars, where I'm going to discuss additional topics as you see here on the slide. Thanks for watching. Goodbye.